The views expressed in this podcast are simply the opinions of the guests and the hosts from their perspective. These opinions aren't necessarily facts, nor with the intent to defame any person or establishment. This is not legal, medical, financial, nor spiritual advice. Hey, welcome back. It's the Alternative Perspectives podcast.
You catch me there. I'm trying to find a spot.
Nah, man, you find a spot in the meantime. I'll do the intro. Right? Arnaldo and Judy on the inside. Final episode.
After some time, too.
Yeah, well, as no man jumped into that. Yeah. Final episode for the year, but we took a little hiatus. Right? So, COVID got into the camp in one way or the other.
Yes. There's some health issues to address.
Yeah. But yeah, so COVID got in and we could probably jump into that at some point.
Well, that's what we're probably going to be jumping into today. Right. Because that's 2021 in review, you know?
Yeah, right. Yeah. I mean, we're doing a review the year, what it has been like, you know, if our expectations with the situation if we live up to the expectations or if things were different.
Yeah.
So...
Well, and the thing is, as I was telling you, when we were discussing how we're going to do this final episode of 2021, we came up with the year in review idea. And what we really wanted to do was to, you know, go through all the top stories from 2021. But then I started to realize,
most of the top stories
were COVID-related.
Yeah.
And I mean, and anything, there were important things happening out in the world outside of COVID. But people really weren't paying that close attention to them. So 2021, again, much of 2020, is really the story of COVID. And, well, I'll ask you afterwards how you were feeling around this time last year. But I remember I was feeling actually hopeful, right? I remember I said last year that I thought we would have a carnival in the, I'd like to say summer, but the August vacation period here in Trinidad. I thought that's how well the situation would have progressed. And I also thought that we would have been, I assumed that Trinidad would have been a country with a high uptake of the vaccine, voluntarily. I didn't even think that we would have had to go down the road of discussing mandates because I thought that the prime minister had such a sway over a large percentage of the population that once he advised it, people would have taken it up en masse. None of those things materialized. Nothing like that happened in 2021.
No, the thing is, to be honest with you, I was indifferent to the whole thing because, you know, I realized I just had to wait to see how things would have unfolded, right? Now, coming into all this time last year, things were eased up last year around this time.
Right.
Right? So,
they were as easy as they are now, eh? Or probably actually...
No, it was easier because last year, around this time, the beaches were open again
without restriction.
Things were a bit easier, remember? They were having... They started to have little events, things like, you know, little small events with people separated and whatnot. Mm-hmm. Because...
But you can have those now.
Was it? Well, I guess in safe zones, under that safe zone thing. Last year, it was not a safe zone thing. It was, you just go out there.
Well, they didn't have vaccines.
Right.
So they couldn't have safe zones last year.
But the thing is, and they didn't have vaccines, and people were going out, and the numbers still nowhere close to where they are now.
Right.
So... So I thought, okay, things looking like it catching up. I honestly didn't think it would have reached where it is now. I didn't think we would have reached 900 cases a day kind of situation.
Oh.
I really didn't think it would have reached that.
Well, I'll be honest. I thought that our bout with the virus was coming in the early stages of this year. So I did expect a spike. And I was telling people that and it didn't. I mean, to be honest, I didn't see 2,000 and something or 2,800 now deaths. But I thought that we had to have our turn for what was happening everywhere else. Ultimately, I thought that we wouldn't be able to duck and hide forever. Every country had to go through their battles, essentially. And I didn't think I didn't think it would have been as bad as it ended up being. And I didn't think it would have lasted this long. I thought that we'd have been, by April or so, we would have been through the peak. It wouldn't have been 2,800 deaths. And by the summer period, I felt we would have been out of the danger zone, essentially. I thought the pandemic would have begun to die down by then. Combination of the vaccines and just generally, you know, the virus having run its course.
Because, all right, like, for instance, you're talking about, like, the vaccines and whatnot, right?
Mm-hmm.
You thought people would have been...
Yeah. You know, I thought Trinidad would have been one of those countries where because of how popular Dr. Rowley was at the time, and how little resistance you saw from the population when it came to any of the restrictions that were put in place. I thought once you say vaccines here, take vaccines, all arguments would have been done.
Okay. I thought from the start that it would not have been easy. I thought plenty would have taken it, but over time. So I try to watch it as people in the tech world would watch things where it have the early adopters and then the batches come right after. And I thought that is how it would have happened. I think it's happening like that though. It might just be taking much longer than they wanted to. And I think they might have set some unreasonable goals when it comes to vaccinations.
Remember they were talking about 70%, right?
Right.
But now it seems like 70%. First of all, it seems like herd immunity is not a thing, right? It does not.
But true vaccination.
Anyhow, it does. If herd immunity means that the virus goes the way of the swine flu, I don't think that's happening at all, right? And that's what they were suggesting would happen if we get to 70%. Now, first of all, that figure has shot up to like 90%. You had to be like 90%. And now we're not even sure if that would happen. But I don't know how quickly they had planned to get 70% of the people.
I remember they gave some real weird timeline. So like vaccines started here when?
February. Early February.
Right?
Yeah. I think it was limited to certain people.
Right. So so the main sort of vaccine rush started in June, I believe. Like when they say when they said they opened it up for everybody and everybody could go, which is like June.
Right, yeah.
Right?
Right.
So I would want to say for everybody, right? Yeah. So I would say June. And they were giving us dates for like August or September.
September. Well, they were saying September before the vaccines had arrived.
Right.
So like early February when they had begun to talk about, giving it to the older and the more vulnerable. They were talking about September then. I think what happened was that they didn't procure the vaccines as fast as they thought.
Right.
So I don't know if they were still talking about September in June.
Well, then after that, they started to push it down more to the end of the year, looking at 70% kind of thing, right? Now, as I say, when they made the September suggestion or statement, we didn't have enough vaccines to even vaccinate 50% of the population.
Right.
You understand? They didn't even know where they were finding that from.
Right.
So, as like, all right, whatever. Then my thought was, listen, there are going to be people who will rush to take it. Or there are going to be a few people who will take it. Then you're going to see some people after a while say, okay, they take it and nothing happened to them. They didn't mutate.
Right.
So we will start to take it. And then the bigger group, well, all of them taking it. So I will start to take it. And then, I never thought we'd have reached 100%. I think we would have probably...
Well, that's an impossibility.
So I never thought that. I never thought we would have reached even probably 85%. I thought we would have probably reached 75%. But over a lengthy period of time. Why I'm saying that, I think, you know, the late stragglers starting to come in now, and I don't know if it's by brute force, but somebody I know, and he was real hesitant. Well, he was real against that vaccine thing, real hesitant. Everything he could have found on social media to send me off, or people send him in WhatsApp groups to send me about the vaccine and issues or whatever, he would have sent me, right?
Yeah.
And today I was talking to him and he said, well, I went and take my job, you know. Mm-hmm. You know, and he's like, yeah, my wife, she went and get it. And I said, well, at the end of the day, we're sleeping in the same bed, so, you know.
I don't understand, Sandy, but the job is the virus.
Yeah, I know. So,
what are you sleeping in the same bed? Right? If he had said, if something happened to her, we could be in the same boat together.
Mm.
But anyway. Yeah.
Well, probably he was saying, if he didn't, she might not want him on the bed. I don't know. Right. You understand?
All right. No, that's even stupider, but fine. Yeah.
Right?
Mm.
So, and he was saying that, and he's like, yeah, so I went and take it. So I think people would have come around. I think people see people take it and see time pass and realize that, you know, nobody mutating. Much people in dying, and well, as you said, it might be extremely hard to prove if anybody died as a result of.
Yeah, because I mean, you don't stop hearing about people who were recently vaccinated and had some stroke or passed away or something like that. And so, but it's never ever declared to be the fault of the vaccine. So, you know, so it doesn't. I'm not saying that it is happening, but what I'm saying is, even if it was, it would be very difficult to pinpoint it anyway.
Right.
To know what is
So the thing is, because I think no medical professional would, you know, come out and admit that right now, especially in Trinidad.
And I mean, and they aren't going to be very interested in investigating. You know, let's say you get vaccinated and then 2 days later you die from a stroke. I don't think anybody's going to be okay with expending resources on doing research to find out if that was really
because and you know, just not to go too far from the topic, but I was watching an interview with Dr. Drew, right? And he was saying that a lot of his colleagues, they're afraid to do a lot of things when it comes to the virus to really check and see if people are dying from the vaccine. To experiment with certain things to get people better. You see, a lot of his colleagues are afraid to prescribe
certain things. Yeah.
Even though, you know, there's proof that it works, but they're so just trying to play the correct game politically.
Right.
Or medically, if you want to put it like that, that they just
So I don't think it's gonna be it will always be a tough task to pin any particular adverse event to the vaccine itself. And even when you are able to do that, you're not gonna get much purchase for the idea that now means we should change course. You know, nobody's gonna be interested in doing that. But I mean, I hear you when you say that you thought it would have happened over time, but I was really, really surprised to see how many people, that, you know, they're sycophants when it comes to the PNM, but they were not very trusting when it came to this, you know? And I didn't think that would happen. I envisioned two things happening. Us having a bout with it in the early part of the year that would frighten people. And then on top of that, when the vaccines arrive, you know, their Lord and Savior, Dr. Rowley, tells them to take it. So they'll just, you know, volunteer.
And the thing is, I didn't think...
I should mention, I do understand that there is a large proportion of the population that aren't PNM fans. Eh? But what I'm seeing is a lot of the resistance is coming from, and at least from my opinion, from people who would normally form part of that camp.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. The thing is, I didn't think we would have had a very bad time delimited, because you remember the borders were still closed earlier on. And I honestly thought they would have kept the borders closed much longer. Not that I'm saying I wanted that, but I thought they would have, because of how fearful, you know,
the problem is, remember, it came before the borders opened. So we already started to deal with Delta and it was already starting to run wild. So the border closure.
No, but they didn't admit the Delta before the border.
Well, right, no,
because
but, right.
The Brazilian, right, which is the, what does he want? Whatever, right? The Brazilian came through the unofficial borders, right? And that's when things start to get wild first. So now it's like, all right, cool, this would happen. And then we went back into some form of lockdown again. So I say, okay, now things would probably Because I kind of understood how it happened and why it happened. So I was like, all right, cool. So just to get this back under control. But then...
The thing is, by the time... The entire problem with how Trinidad and Tobago has dealt with this is that, and why it feels so much more frustrating to us here than it would in certain other places, is that we persisted for so long with policies that weren't necessarily making sense.
Mm-hmm.
So that when we started to experience a surge, this is the time when everybody else was kind of going back to normal, but we now had to go back into lockdown because, so for instance, when you're talking about the border closure, they had to open the borders eventually. They had to, you understand? It was doing too much to the travel industry and it was making conducting business in Trinidad and Tobago way too difficult, right? Now, if they had reopened the borders after 4 months, 5 months, 6 months, then it wouldn't feel so frustrating. They wouldn't have been forced to do it in the midst of another surge.
Right.
If you understand what I'm saying. But because so much time had passed and it's kind of like with the lockdowns, they can't go back into lockdown now because we've done two lockdowns and we're still in the midst of a surge now. So now you look crazy because, but look at what's happening and you're opening the beach and you're opening the, but I have to open these at some point in time.
Mm-hmm.
And you've had them closed. You extended both lockdowns longer than they needed to be. Well, in particular, the first one was extended much longer than it needed to be because you were feeling like a hero. You're keeping this thing under control. But we have been under these restrictions for so long that, and these restrictions are unsustainable. They have to be lifted at some point in time. But now that the virus has inevitably started to wreak havoc, look stupid because you have to do it in the midst of a surge.
Which is a next thing that I never thought about until I mentioned it here, right? Because you remember, and this is a no way to try and put on Dr. Rowley. I mean, if he end up down, he end up down because, you know, things he said or did. But you remember at many points, he kind of pointed out to other countries how they were falling short now. You understand?
Yeah, yeah.
And then... look where we end up, if you understand what I'm saying.
Exactly.
So, I wonder how he feels now, knowing that, you know, he points out this one. Oh, this one opened up too early, and look what I'm to this one. And this one do this, and look what I'm to that one. Yeah. And
now you have to open up in the midst of a surge.
Mm.
Now, you because, and this is what it ultimately irritates me, because we are now being forced to answer the questions that nobody wanted to answer, that I was asking at the beginning of this thing, that nobody wanted to answer then. Okay, we locked down. I get that. But what is the strategy for coming out? Because when you come out, it's going to come.
Mm-hmm.
So we cannot keep relying on unsustainable non-pharmaceutical or non-medical interventions, because those things cannot, they're by definition, unsustainable. So they can't last forever. And when you remove them, you're in a monkey pants anyway. So you ultimately have now to... when the virus does what the virus does, and it was doing everywhere, and everywhere has had to deal with it, you now are dealing with that after having been under restrictions for almost a year. It began.
So now you're like, where's the point?
Exactly. Now it feels extra frustrating because you're seeing in other places that people who tinkered with the lockdowns, they lift it, and then the people were back to normal, and then they kind of clamped down again. So it didn't feel like a complete year of frustration. For us, we haven't had, nobody has been able to hold a FET legally. And when I say a fet, I mean not one of them things they had for Carnival.
Oh.
Well, that was the only one. That's the first one that we know of, and it's arguable whether that was legal or not. But you haven't been able to go to a proper fet, since last year March. You understand? Whereas Miami had a Carnival, and
people having parties. People,
yeah. you understand?
So had Face Off, which is a party right. in Grenada.
Exactly. Yeah. And I mean, Jamaica is probably the only, and even I think Jamaica had
real thing also.
No, but there was a period in time when they weren't able to, but right. but now come to think of it, even they have had some events during that time. Trinidad and Tobago has not. So we have had the longest period of completely restricted life, plus we ended up with the same death that we were trying to avoid in the first place. And when people were asking you the question, what you're going to do when you lift these restrictions? Yeah, you weren't answering, but now you're being forced to answer that.
Well, the thing is, as I say, I wouldn't want his job, to be real honest.
Oh, yes, yes, that's right. 100%.
Especially, I think, especially in Trinidad, I mean, because, I mean, everywhere probably have it, but I think probably in Trinidad it seems louder. The damn if you do, damn if you don't kind of situation. And the politicians in Trinidad and Tobago, they play the political game all the time, rather than the leadership game. This is what we are going to do. And if it doesn't work, they say, woo. Right. Yeah, we fall short there and we will try something else. So I guess...
Well, you see, but I get where you're coming from. And no, I don't want this job either. Mainly because I don't think I could do the job. I don't think I'm made for the job. But the most important, I'm not going to apply for the work because I can't do the work. The problem is, and this is generally in politics, not just in Trinidad and Tobago, but everywhere, these politicians are just ambitious individuals who want to get where they want to get. And the actual work is just, that's secondary. What they dreamt of was winning the prize of, yeah, I reach. I'm now minister, now prime minister, now whatever. But now that we're here and we had to do the hard work of leading, nobody's really on board for that. And we are suffering now because of that. This situation is one where there's no easy fix, right? There's no way to come out of this smelling of roses from all angles. But this could have been managed a lot better if we had leaders who were able to manage the population's expectations during this time. And I say that a lot and everybody's look at me like I'm crazy. You know, a good example. People will say right now we're in the midst of a crisis, right? Mm. And so when they argue about whether we should mandate vaccines if they have the moral authority to do that or whatever, people say, oh, well, look at this situation. I don't know if you remember, but last year, I believe it was after we had the elections and we had a little flare-up after that, right? And the Alcine was on the TV doing his usual, oh, you better behave, what is up? And he was essentially, as part of his messaging to get people to keep in line and to comply with the regulations, he said, he was talking about the rate of spread at the time. He said, at the current rate that we're going, we may see, and he paused, a death a day. And he said that in a very dramatic tone. He paused for effect. And then after that, he said, and none of us want to see that. Now, Terence the Alcine will bite off your hand if he gets a death a day. Because a death a day, he couldn't fathom that last year. But now that he's dealing with death in the teens every day.
In the teens?
Well, we go back to teens because it was 16. It went back to teens for now, right? So now that he's dealing with that, how does one death a day look?
The thing is, you know, one thing I was wondering, because, you know, in like South Africa, where they have a low vaccination rate, but it seems like they do have much debt. And what do you think?
Well, from Omicron, because they had a lot of debt with Delta.
Well, even with Delta, what they're saying is they still didn't have the amount of debt that they should have had, right? And what they're saying is is it possible because a lot of them got the virus because they were kind of careless before, right? So a lot of them got the virus and end up developing some degree of natural immunity. So now, even before Omicron, when Delta was there, even though a lot of them weren't vaccinated, people were getting it. Yes, some were dying, but not at the rate that they thought people would have died at.
Well, I mean, not comparable to some Western nations, but they were leading Africa at a point in time. So... but what you're saying,
is it that because they were kind of wild and kind of,
well, okay. From what we've seen here in Trinidad, I think that we would have had a gazillion more deaths if we were trying to do that. Well, let it run. And, you know, once people get some level of natural immunity, then we could kind of go about our lives. It appears that would have been a very unwise thing to do in Trinidad.
Well, is it? If we did it in the early stages where we had the original variant that may not have killed much people.
But you see, you didn't know that at the time.
Right. This is what I said. So being saying that this was the plan, we're looking back.
Right.
So is it that if we if we are just letting you run
yeah.
crazy with the original variant,
yeah. mm.
people would have gotten ill. Mm. Not much would have died. People would have had some degree of natural immunity. When Brazilian come, mm. Delta came, people would have been better prepared to deal with it.
Well, maybe. But and that's the problem. You see, and people have this attitude where every time you complain about what the government is doing, they'll say, so what you gonna do? And it, when people... Because human beings have a real problem understanding that maybe there's nothing you can do.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it might have been better for them to have let this thing run, and who died, and we had some level of natural immunity. So when it comes back around, we'd have been cycling and getting less and less and less. I'm not saying that is what to do. I am mm-hmm. not an expert on the issue.
Yeah.
But what I'm saying is maybe that might have been. Who knows? It might have been better over the course of 5 years. You might have ended up with the same amount of death. We're doing here now, but we'd have been out of the woods a lot faster than now.
And probably the economy in a better position.
Exactly. So who knows? But the problem, because nobody was willing to even contemplate that, because politicians, oh, you mad thing, because remember Boris Johnson was going to do that in England, and then he get it, and then thing, and he reverse it. So that's what I mean by the lack of strong leadership. In Sweden, despite all of the criticisms that came, you know what Sweden said? Listen, this thing shows no signs of disappearing anytime soon. So whatever measures we implement have to be sustainable. They have to be measures that the Swedish people can generally live with.
Mm.
Because we can't impose things for 3 months and then when they lift it, we come back out and we back doing the whole thing again. So yes, we're not going to just let it run wild. We are going to advise people to work from home. We're going to advise people to wash their hands, social distance, blah, 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 blah. They actually followed their pandemic plan that they had in place. Everybody else abandoned the pandemic plan and run with lockdowns and all these craziness. But they decided to do that. And I think I told you this, the very first time I heard that Anders Tegnell fella, he's the health, I don't know if he's called a minister in Sweden, but the first time I heard him speak, I was like, wow, that sounds like the actual kind of leader you should have at this point in time. Not a leader who willing to give into public panic, who could be emotionally blackmailed by the media. Oh, you don't care about people. No, you have to speak to your people and say, listen, there's no easy way out of this. There's no way that we're coming out of this looking squeaky clean. You know? We're going to try to manage the situation. We have lots of different things to consider. Numbers from COVID is just one thing that we need to consider, but we also need to consider people's mental health. We need to consider the economy. We need to consider all these different things.
You know, anytime I talk about people's mental health with this, they say, your mental health if you're dead.
Yeah.
People still act today like once you get the virus, you are going to die.
And what they fail to, they seem to only care about, the compassion only extends to the people they fear will die from COVID. They don't seem to care anything about the vast majority of us who will survive COVID and what sort of state the nation will be in after. They don't care about that. And it's not because they're really compassionate. It's because, well, listen, they're scared. And they, like most human beings, they only focus on what's in front of them as opposed to the problem that might come around the corner. And this is where strong leadership would have been ideal. And where you would have people managing. And the point that's making with Terence Yeltsin and the one case a day. People, to some extent, how people feel is really dictated by how the politicians talk about the situation. One death a day sounded like craziness 6 months ago, but now we wish.
No, but remember he was also the one who said, you know, it will never run rampant in Trinidad. Remember he said that in a clip.
I see. I don't know.
Yeah. When I really need to go and look for that clip.
No, you mean he didn't say that it would never. You're talking about the one when he was on the morning show on TV6.
Yeah, and
what he said is if it came here, it would only be, you know, it would just be a one or two isolated incidents.
It would never. Yeah.
But believe me, the people of Trinidad are big. No, again, this is why I could never take him seriously. He just talks out of his ass. He is probably the most disappointing. I shouldn't say disappointing because I never had high expectations. Mm. But he, to me, appears to be the most the simpleton of the cabinet. And he's just an unserious person who's just there to spout talking points. You know, he is more interested in looking good for his boss, you know, and towing the political line than actually being a serious minister and managing the situation. Because so many times because my problem is, and I've mentioned this before, his thing with the masks and that issue with that same interview we did, how the mother neck he knew that it would never run rampant. At that point in time, what did he know about COVID?
Right, exactly.
Yeah. What did he know? All he could have simply said, well, we monitor any situation at this point in time. It doesn't look like it's going to be a threat to Trinidad and Tobago, but we know there's a developing situation, blah, blah. You don't want to be a brain surgeon to answer that way, but he actually laughed. Like, the average person in Trinidad. As a matter of fact, I remember reading an article in the early stages where he was telling people more people dying from the flu, but yet still we all talking about coronavirus or about COVID. That's where the phrase he used was, I can't remember the exact phrase, but the sentiment he was expressing essentially was that we were also concerned about COVID because it was making news internationally when the flu was killing, I think at the point in time was 51 people had died in the country from the flu or something like that. And he was, again, downplaying it. We knew.
And where we are now.
The masks.
I just want to stick in this here. So, a lot of people are expecting after the boat ride situation to hear him come again to talk about, oh God, how like he behave. And then last time he wept and whatever, right? And I saw a video of him today. Yeah, I don't even know if I should put this out there. I mean, I don't have a reason to break him. I mean, you might have more reason, and I will say why just now. Mm-hmm. But I saw he was walking outside Next 99 studio.
Yeah. I saw the video.
And you know the music was playing, and he was dancing.
Yeah.
And I was like, you were weeping when we had 100 cases a day. We in the 600 cases and think no. And you are dancing. So is it that when you wept,
it's all theater.
Right, it was a lie and you were playing? Or is it that no, he's just dancing to get over the whole everything not going on?
We should mention he was wearing a mask at the point in time. So he wasn't part of no party or nothing.
Yeah.
He was passing by a studio with us playing music, and he was showing support for the people playing the music. Right. That would look like to me. Right? But why go out breaks for him?
Because, let me tell you why. Remember that night we were coming up the road? Which car I had, boy? I can't remember which car I had. Mm-hmm. And he was driving his
Ford.
His Mustang. Over the speed limit. And I said, Dan, let me record him now. And he's dog, you're like real shipping his dog. Dog. I was like, oh, so let me record him. Because at the end of the day, you know, they want to jump people, but driving over the speed limit.
Yeah.
He's driving over the speed limit, and you can simply record the speedometer in my car and him and show you he's driving over the speed limit. He didn't want to do it. I'll never forgive him for that.
But why had to break from him? Why that gonna make me have to break from me?
Not break from him, break from him. Okay, break from him then. I'll never forgive him for that.
Because the way we was working at the time. Because I didn't want to deal with the headache of what would happen because the way we were working. But like, no, I wouldn't tell you not to do that because I don't have any concern about that place anymore. But the situation with the masks, again, he didn't just say, well, at present, with the current data out there, it doesn't appear to be that masks are warranted and da da da. He spoke as if he had personally conducted those epidemiological studies himself, or at least he had read those studies critically, and he understands all of the data, and he can tell you without a doubt that it is not just unwise to wear a mask, but it's actually, you reach this point where it's foolish. You're putting yourself at greater risk. And then, however many, 3 weeks later?
Nah, I don't think it took so long. Because
I can't remember how long.
Nah, it didn't take that long because you remember Fauci come and say one thing, and then in a matter of a few days, Fauci come and change his song. It was days.
I remember I was telling you that point in time. I get the impression they just watching what's happening abroad and bringing it here. Because he spoke almost verbatim exactly what he said, almost verbatim what Dr. Fauci said in the interview on 60 Minutes or wherever he was on. And so my thing is, people will always say, well, you know, the thing is, so he, a man can't make a mistake. He can't be wrong. My issue isn't him being wrong, you know, is the fact that when he speaks with such confidence that how I...
And conviction.
And how do I... He isn't reserved in any way he speaks. He doesn't hedge his bets in any way. He doesn't say, well, you know, for now, this is how it's looking, but the situation... No, he doesn't speak with any sort of reservation in his tone. He because he's an actor, essentially, he's just, you know, there to spout platitudes and toe the party line. His concern isn't the accuracy of his information. No. His concern is looking and sounding competent or in command of the situation. So he's talk shit. And then, so me now, so which day else should I listen to? Which time were you, right, you know, confident? Because you speak with the same degree of confidence every time.
All the time. Mm-hmm.
So.
Like when they came up with the idea to open up the vaccination to everybody as a free fall. Because as I said, today is a rewind, we're going back to the year.
Yeah.
When I saw that move, I lost all faith. No, I didn't have much. Don't get me wrong. I didn't have much. But I lost all faith in them, you know. Because I was like, listen, at that point, it was almost impossible to get with that. They were doing the appointments, right? And it was almost impossible to get an appointment at that point.
Yeah.
I tried.
Yeah, man.
My wife and I tried.
Yeah.
Right? And couldn't get an appointment. Book up all over.
Mm-hmm.
Had to run a racket.
Mm-hmm.
Right? To get Humada and the vaccinated. It's a racket we had to run to it happen for them. You understand what I'm saying? And then, bam, when they come to say, I was like, wait, hold on. So if it right now they already, so is it that there's such a big disconnect between the people on the ground who organizing and doing the vaccinating and the leaders and yeah.
And to put it on to try to put it on the health authority managers and so on. It's like, to me, that now, even if in fact that might be true, you know, the minister is not himself supposed to be overseeing each and every site. But knowing how things happen in this country, you would have thought that he would have done the most he could do to ensure that when that thing kicked off, they didn't have anything like what ended up happening, you know? So even if he had to get a reassurance from those regional health authority managers or whomever,
I think even
that you should have been satisfied that when you all do this thing, we ain't going to have people, you know, like it's a refugee camp.
Right. Because the thing is, and because remember at that point in time, we were hearing a lot of talk about vaccine hesitancy. The prime minister talking a lot about, people. And I was like, I not see any level of vaccine hesitancy that they speaking about.
Right.
And I mean, you've seen people on social media talking about it, and I had to tell a few people, yo, there is not the real world.
Yeah.
Right? Your 10 friends and the two of them who might be hesitant, that is not the real world. It's bigger than that, right? And I knew that because, as I said, trying to get my mother and my aunts and they who were older and some of them with different comorbidities and whatnot, trying to get them vaccinated, we realized it was very, very hard to get out. So I was like, clearly, it can be hard if there's this great deal of hesitancy.
Yeah.
You understand?
Yeah.
I'm not saying there wasn't any at all, but clearly it wasn't as much as...
And well, at the point, and remember we were saying this on the podcast, that the Prime Minister was stoking up anger and he was kind of throwing fuel on the fire with respect to the vaccine hesitancy issue at a point in time where they didn't even have enough vaccines to give to those who wanted it. So you would have thought that, you know, a prudent leader would have been like, hey, let me just hush my mouth about that until it becomes an issue.
Because
right now,
I'll go look bad.
Right now, I talking like if I'm preparing for war with the vaccine hesitant, but there are people who want to get vaccinated. Give me my vaccine. I'm begging for it. Give me. So he should have waited until it actually, like, we're in a situation now where everybody could get it easy, like peasy. And now if you're dealing with hesitancy, then you bring it up. But again, this is poor leadership because you think that helped the situation? I don't know if it would have made a difference, but you think it helped the situation for him to be start talking like that preemptively? Because what you've already begun to do is get people's back up, like, whoa, 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 you talking to me like I's your child?
Yeah, yeah.
And you could tell me what is to inject in my body?
Yeah, I think it, obviously in reasoning with people better, it would have, I think the outcome would have been much, much different. Just trying to be more reasonable. And I think some people just don't like to be told what to do and when to do it.
And you don't have a right to. That's the most important thing. You are a representative of the people. You're not my ruler. You know, I didn't elect a father, or I didn't elect anybody, but I certainly didn't elect them. But the point is, even if I voted, I wouldn't have been voting for a daddy. I would have been voting for a representative. You're not a ruler of the people. You're a representative of the people. Yes, you do have a certain, the government, whoever is in government has a certain degree of power due to the, or stemming from the constitution that will allow them to take certain actions that could be deemed to be ruling over people. But ultimately, your role is not to tell people what to do. The role of any government, the central role of any government, is to protect the rights of their citizens, right? That is the central role. Mm. All the other shit the government is getting to, you could argue whether that is, they should be doing that or not. Many of those things could be done much better if the government stayed the fuck out of it. But the fundamental reason why a government has to exist, or people feel a government needs to exist, is that people's rights, individual rights, would not be protected if somebody didn't have a monopoly on the use of power. Mm-hmm. If I couldn't rely on you to respect my right to life if there wasn't a police officer to make sure that if you try to kill me, you'll end up in a... Right. So that's the role of the government. So the government is there to protect your civil liberties. So your civil liberties, actually, people would make it seem now as if that's irrelevant to the topic. That should be the very first thing the government... Mm-hmm. considers, not whether they could find a loophole in the constitution to force it to take a vaccine or not.
But the thing is, and I think what we have seen throughout this thing, throughout the year, and probably since last year, is that they are all willing to press on your civil liberties.
Yeah,
and so in that case, can we say that the government is out of line?
They are, yes, not just the government, all these asshole legal commentators who come in to make constitutional arguments for the case for mandates and all that, but all of them are out of line. All of them. It stems from the fact that we ultimately do not really respect civil liberties. We claim we do and we pretend we do, and when it's convenient, so, you know, if we don't want to be harassed by the police, we all of a sudden we have civil liberties. But if there's something that we feel, all those people who are talking about, mandate the vaccine, like, when did you become the ruler of my body? You know what I'm saying? Where do you have forget whether it even makes sense with the fact that the vaccine is, the virus spreads through the vaccinated like nothing. Forget all that. I mean, why are you so eager? Why, if you really respected civil liberties, you would be starting from the premise of, I don't want to force somebody to do nothing. And I could hear an argument where you could say, I don't want to, brother, but this or that, and how we could find a way around. But it should always be with civil liberties in the very middle of the discussion, and we all branching off from there, and we see, okay, how can we achieve what we want to achieve without doing that?
But the thing is, one of the things that people would say, and I mean, obviously we discussed all these things before, recapping, people would say, but between, no, this doesn't make sense, right?
Yeah, I know what you're going to say.
But they would say that, but when you don't take it, you now could hamper my life.
Right.
Which, you know, whether you're vaccinated or not.
Right.
Right? And if you're vaccinated, then I should be able to do less harm to you. Should be able to do no harm, but okay, I should be able to do less harm to you. Then you might get the argument that the nurses and the hospitals, because what they say, 90% now are the people who are in the hospital and are dying. I think 90% we need to say 99% or something. So are the people who die? No.
I don't know about those figures. Just over the past month. Well, I mean, I don't know about everything going on, but I just find it very strange that I'm hearing those figures. And just in the past month, I know of 4 people who were fully vaccinated who passed away. Mm-hmm. And they are being counted as COVID deaths. So I just find that really, really strange. The only people I know who've died from COVID in the past 5 months have been fully vaccinated individuals. So I just find it really, really strange when I hear those figures. Right. But let's assume they are right.
Right. So, and then they would say, well, so, you know, you're tying up the thing. Yeah.
Right. And my thing is, it is not an absolute. No rights are absolute. Mm-hmm. So that you have somebody making that argument would have a very good point that in order to protect, to ensure all of us have our civil liberties protected, it might mean some infringement on the rights of individuals to do what they want to do. And that's okay. But if we were really having a discussion about that, then the argument would kind of cease when the vaccines aren't stopping the spread. You would have thought that if you were really somebody who didn't want to force people to take this thing, once it was found that it wasn't stopping the spread, it should have made it easy for you. It's like, oh, okay, well, if it is something, well, then it really is just me I'm protecting. So then I don't need to care about you.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Because I could get it from a vaccinated person. I could get it from an unvaccinated person.
The most important thing is if I have it, it might kill me.
All I'm doing is I'm preparing myself for the inevitable running I will have with the virus. And therefore, I'm doing the best I can, and if the best I can, I feel, is with the vaccine.
You know, as you just said, preparing yourself for the inevitable running with the virus.
Right.
I think that is a conversation that we needed to have.
They're not going to have it because they want you to feel that. They want to keep using this argument about protecting you. They want to use the argument that I could force you to get vaccinated to come to work because we are protecting other people.
Mm-hmm.
It will undermine the argument if you told everybody, hey, this thing ain't going away and you will catch it at some point in time. Mm-hmm. Whereas now, next year, it doesn't matter. And in many cases, if you're vaccinated and in relatively good health, you probably want to catch it now, mm-hmm. as opposed to as you get older and your immune system ceases to function well and so on and so forth. So you should actually, if you've done all you can do to prepare yourself by, you know, getting vaccinated and boosted and whatever, you would probably prefer to meet it now than 4 years down the road.
Mm-hmm.
Because 4 years down the road, you might miss some booster shots, you mightn't get vaccinated, or you're naturally getting older and sicker, you might develop a comorbidity, mm-hmm. and you catch it then that's a problem. So that discussion you're trying to have there, they will never want to introduce that discussion because it undermines the arguments they will have for forcing people to take it.
And I think that is the problem when politics and science meet up now, eh? Mm-hmm. When they jam up on the junction, that is where the bacchanal is. You understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Because I think most people in science would tell you that by now. You know? Most people in science, mm-hmm. would say, yeah, we're going to now. At the end of the day, this is going to hit most people, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I think they will tell you that. And
it's endemic. They've used that language already.
Right, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And that if that is the case, then it's going to become something that is cyclical. It's never going to stop me. Well, I shouldn't say never, but it's not likely. No, there's no evidence it's going to stop mutating. You're not going to vaccinate the virus away.
Mm-hmm.
All you can do is prepare yourself so you have as much protection as possible when you finally encounter it. But like I say, they don't want to introduce that discussion because then how are you going to say, well, you know, you're unvaccinated, you're a threat to the people around you.
Mm.
No. No, you can't have that argument. And that argument is being used to guilt trip, to bully, to do whatever, to justify things that are unjustifiable, which essentially are mandates. Now, listen, I had this discussion with a friend of mine the other day, and the government's desire or the objective to raise vaccination numbers, nothing's wrong with that, you know. Nothing's wrong with that. I could completely understand why they'd want to do that. You know, everybody, boy, thing, they're getting paid to promote this thing and there's some new world order thing. Now, I can't say whether there's a new world order trying to be established or not, but if there is, I don't think they brought Keith Rowley and Kamala Prasad Bisesa and all these people into a room and got them involved in the conspiracy. So I don't think, and you don't even have to reach there. It's a rational thing. They want to get back to the economy performing as best as it can. And they think the only way to do that is to administer vaccines. as many vaccines as possible so we have the least amount of hospitalizations. Not because they care about you or me or whatever, but they would care about a broken healthcare system because that'll look good. So, and all of these things are just tools that they're using to get those numbers up. But the problem is that, again, it comes back to leadership. I don't have an issue with the objective. I just, because you have very few tools in your leadership belt, you are undermining your objective. Because when you say things to people that don't make sense, then the people will be like, well, it had to be a conspiracy. You go, why are you forcing me to take this thing? And when I take it, I could still get it. And then I have to take one. You're telling me, oh, to vaccinate, to operate. And then, but then I got out of vaccinated again 3 months later, and then again 3 months later, and then again 3 months later. What is this? And then you don't want to hear any discussion about early treatment to keep people out here. Nothing like that. Nothing. You're only talking about vaccines. But that's because these dum-dums, some clowns advising them, telling them, well, that's the way you can't. If you say anything negative or you allow any negative talk about the vaccine, it will lead to vaccine hesitancy. So you keep one message, even if the message don't make sense. And that is what is undermining. They're not having they're not attempting to reason with the public of Trinidad and Tobago like they're adults. They're trying to treat you like how a parent would teach a child. Hey, I force you to eat your vegetables. I can make up whatever story I want. You know, just eat your vegetables. And then once you eat your vegetables, I don't care what you do after that.
So. And then the thing is then the child, which is normally happen, the child now will start to get brighter.
Right.
The child start to get older and then start to build resentment towards the parent because they're like, but wait, now you was lying to me? You understand? My parents, they were lying to me. Yeah. You understand what I'm saying?
The things they were saying weren't making sense. No, you would say, well, I was trying to get you to do what good for you, to eat your vegetables. Right, but and you could make the argument with it when you're dealing with children that maybe that's what you have to do because you can't reason with an 8-year-old or a 7-year-old. And their argument would be, well, you see, the average individual can't understand all the information. I don't care.
I don't think that would be the argument.
Well, I know if you pin them down and you had to
argue. If you had to pin them down because they wouldn't want to say that because then.
No. Well, I know, but what I'm saying, if you pin them down, like if you get, because people will make that argument on their behalf. Like, yeah, I've said that to many people. They're like, well, boy, but you don't remember everybody bright like you, you know. So you saying if they give people the information they'll make, they could make their own choices. And so, but they know that that's not the case. So they're talking to, they're governing at the lowest common denominator then. As they're governing for the most retarded of us. I don't want to hear that. That has nothing to do with me. I could reason. So let me make a decision. Give me the information.
I think I had to push back here, you know. And I think that is one of the reasons I want to leave this country, you know. I think because they're governing to suit the lowest common denominator. But I think the lowest common denominator is the majority of this country.
I'm not doubting that. I think the lowest common denominator is probably the majority of most countries. Most countries on planet Earth. Very few exceptions. Even the United States, I would think the lowest common denominator is.
I agree. Of course, majority. That's a whole different conversation because the thing is, I think there's in bigger countries, I think there's an opportunity for it to kind of be to stick more around the people.
Right. Mainly in the States, because even in a country like Canada, where it's humongous, there isn't much diversity in terms of the way people live and behave. There isn't much different. I mean, I've never been to BC, but I have enough people in BC. It's not much different from Ontario. Alberta, you could say, might be slightly different because it's a little bit more conservative in how they operate. But that's a very monolithic country when it comes to how they think. But in the States where there is a lot of diversity in the way people behave, think, and operate. Yeah.
Yeah, so, you know, so I think that is it. I think they understand that I'm trying to address the masses, so I will address them like this. The people who think they're bright, we can go deal with them, or the people who bright and, it don't make sense trying to talk to them. They're in the minority.
I wouldn't disagree, but my argument would be that that is not the contract we signed up for. That I didn't know that that's how Western democracies and Western-style democracies were supposed to operate. I didn't elect, I keep saying this, I didn't elect a daddy who is going to make decisions on my behalf as to what's best for me and then push me in that direction. Like, we are supposed to be electing representatives. What we allow those representatives to do is guided by the rules of the Constitution. The Constitution says the laws govern us, the Constitution governs them, right? And so we elect representatives, and the only things those representatives aren't supposed to do at our request are things that they can't do, you know, because our constitution would not allow it to take place. So, for instance, yes, you could say if we had a referendum tomorrow and 90% of people say, all right, we should enslave Venezuelans who come here. They come here, they're looking for some help. We should be able to use them as free labor. So, you know, we get it, we house them or whatever. And 90% of people say that. But our legislature shouldn't be allowed to enact something like that, even though it is the will of the people, because it violates the terms and conditions set out in our constitution. Those are values that we as a people have said, nah, that's not. That is a right that no matter what the objective is, we can't do that. That is how it's supposed to operate. But not that we elect a mommy and mommy decides, well, you know, this is what's best for the people. So, you know, I make up my mind that that is what's best. I've spoken to all these unelected technocrats, right? I didn't elect Parasram. You understand? I didn't elect whoever it is they're talking to. I didn't elect the WHO. You know what I mean? I didn't vote for the WHO to be my representative, for the WHO to have a firm grip on how I live my life. I didn't do any of that. So, and none of us did. So they are supposed to be representing us. And that means that even if it's the lowest common denominator you're trying to talk to, you have a different program for them. You understand what I'm saying? But when you speak to the people of Trinidad, I don't think the average IQ level in Barbados is much higher than Trinidad and Tobago, but look how Mia Motley deals with the people over there.
I mean, that comes down to the individual and
precisely.
Yeah, and the precisely. Because you know what it come like? Let me tell you what it come like. You ever meet someone and the person just try to talk to everybody like they ship it, but then they meet somebody else and they just try to talk to everybody like normal. Come on, people. And the people who don't understand, they'll try to break it down for them.
Exactly.
So I think that's the difference. Yeah. Me and Motley, you're going on. I'm going to try and talk to everybody as normal as possible.
I think it's also because, and again, I don't live in Barbados, so, and we, you know, we talked about this this year. Excuse me. I don't live in Barbados, so I don't know Me and Motley, her demeanor all the time.
Mm-hmm.
But specifically when she spoke about the vaccines, what you can tell from Mia Motley is that she has respect for people.
Mm-hmm.
So, and because she has respect for the people who may hold a different opinion on the efficacy or safety of the vaccines, and she doesn't think they're retarded people that we just need to just, you know, shut them up and move on. Because she kept saying that we have to deal with this with respect. Mm-hmm. And I think it's because she understands that, or she herself actually does hold a level of respect for the people that she governs. The people we have here, they don't.
They don't,
They're lords. Mm. And they think that you, if you disagree with what they say, you aren't worthy of their respect. So therefore, and that's why all of them so quick to say mandated, because they just think that the people who have any disagreement, who see this any different way, they think you're a clown, you're an idiot, and your voice shouldn't matter in the public square.
We have built a society for a while now, built on segregation, right? And whether it be, because I don't care nobody tell me, both political parties push our race agenda, whether it be indirectly or they push our race agenda, which is a form of segregation within the country, right?
Yeah.
And then they try to push it now with vaccinated, like against unvaccinated.
Right. Yeah.
And then they push it with, I don't want to say supporters, but or people supporting what they want to do against people who don't support what they want to do.
Mm-hmm.
Rather than, you know, take the position of, let me hear and understand your side of it.
Precisely. There's none of that. That is completely vacant. Well, not vacant, it's absent, sorry. Mm. That's completely absent. There's none of that. There's no, all right, let's reach across. And that's, remember, Mia Motley said, I want to come to you to find out. Now, I don't know if she actually did that. But again, the way you speak to the people makes a huge difference. So I would suspect that somebody in Barbados who is hesitant would feel, I'm not saying they will take it, but they will feel a lot more comfortable hearing their leader speak like that. Because their leader, and she said, there are people in my family who they don't believe in holistic medicine and they don't believe in that. They're like, they're not on that. So how I go treat people like, you know, and Rema keep telling you, I don't think Dr. Rowley wants to force people. And I kept, in my mind, I'm keep saying, I think it's because he knows people like that, you know, being from Tobago and probably have plenty of people who close to him who would like, nah, I'm not on that. You know what I mean? And hopefully that would seep in. It will help you to have some respect for the people who might see things differently, but it doesn't come out in how he speaks. He just keeps fueling this fire. And you were talking about segregation in our country. A big divide as well is a class divide.
Well, right. Yeah, well, everything is, I know that because I tell people, I think we have a bigger class divide than a race divide.
Yes.
But the thing is, I just don't know where it came from. And I can't say that any particular person pushed it now.
Well, I think that happens in any society when people begin to become prosperous. Because when you now live in a country where there's the elite and they seem untouchable, and then the rest of us, everybody else kind of on the same level, then you don't find that divide because it's really just the proletariat and the rulers. But what's that? Once prosperity started seeping and certain people start to feel like they're elite now, and the middle, you get a middle class, a burgeoning middle class, and then those middle class, they want to distance themselves as much as possible from the ruffians. Mm. So they try to mimic the behavior of the elites, you know what I mean? And that's what you're seeing taking place in Trinidad and Tobago. They've made it seem, and it's happening around the world, but they've essentially put it, they've framed it from the perspective of the bright, the intelligent, the reasonable, the constructive members of society view the situation this way, and the people who don't, i.e. the unwashed, the ruffians, they are the ones who are talking about global conspiracy and Bill Gates pointing in nanobots and vaccine. And so you don't have to take them on. So when you ask elite in this country, and by elite I don't just mean like, you know, political elite. You know, you ask one of these senior councils and whatever, they start to puff up the chest on, yeah, well, you know, I don't understand why anyone should. Because they haven't even, I'm sure many of them who given long-winded opinions about these things, they don't even know much of the facts regarding the efficacy of the vaccine when it comes to limiting spread. Because they're still saying shit like, well, but you have to, it's reasonable for the government to take this to protect workers. But it's not protecting anybody. It's not protecting anybody from contracting the virus. Now, again, if you want to talk about, you know, protecting the healthcare service, that's a different argument. And we could propose different things for that. You could say, listen, if you come in due to complications from COVID and you're not vaccinated, you don't have access to the hospitals. You don't. Now, people will say they will look heartless or they will look, yeah, but at least, but what they go say, but how else you want us to deal with it? We've asked you to get vaccinated and you don't seem to believe in the vaccine. You say you could fight it off. Well, then fight it off. Don't come to the public hospital when you can't fight it off, when you made them, when you overestimated your health. And again, I don't want to see that, you know, now. I'm simply saying, if the issue is the situation, then we could come at it from a different angle.
Well, I think if you just tell people, first of all, I mean, it's unfortunate that the wrong message went out from the start, right? But because, as you said, if people had just reserved their talking points a bit and wait and observe as the scientists were doing.
Right.
Because, as I said, the politics got involved and the politics really spewed the stupidness, you know? You understand what I'm saying? Because a lot of the scientists were saying, we're waiting to see, time will tell.
Right.
Give it time.
Right.
And these timids were saying,
safe, effective.
And trust the science. Yeah. And the scientists were like, well, we waiting to see too, you know?
Right, yes.
You know what I'm saying?
Because science is analyzing data and we could only have data when time passes.
Right, right. So, if they had just followed, because in my opinion, after a while, I thought the prime minister, the minister, and they should not have been the people mainly speaking in these press conferences.
Mm-hmm.
I think the medical professionals should have been the ones speaking, at least taking the lead, right? If you're coming to implement lockdowns, obviously the medical professionals couldn't be the ones to do that, right? Yeah. But, and I think we might have probably had...
I don't think so. Not in this country. Because I haven't seen any of those. I don't watch the press conferences often, but I haven't seen any clippings from them where I felt, got the impression that there was any great amount of analysis coming from the people who...
Well, you see, here's my thing, right? And I mean, I could be very much wrong with this, but I've always felt like the health officials, they were saying not what needed to be said, but what they thought. I'm not saying that somebody tell them what to say.
Yeah, right, exactly. Yes, right. I know where you're going.
Right, but I felt like they were saying what they thought the government wanted them to say.
Yeah,
which happens. It happens, not here alone, happens everywhere.
Yeah, yeah.
When you're working for the government,
yeah,
you try not to say things that may piss them off or go against their agenda.
And not just that, I think a lot of them feel they have the authority to lie to you if they feel they're lying for a noble cause.
Mm.
They feel like even if they're misstating or overstating something, it's in service of a good... just like somebody, you're looking at some of these media outlets now, and they seem to think it's their job to advance the cause of promoting vaccine mandates.
Mm-hmm.
I see enough articles, you know, on the lead page, their opinion pieces on the lead page of some of these websites. When the opinion pieces get to the lead, I saw on the Express. I don't want to misspeak, so I ain't gonna say which publication, but there was a thing where you see news, you click on the homepage and it's just news articles, right? And you see news headlines. Amongst the news headlines was something saying mandate the vaccines now. So when I clicked it, I was like, who's this saying that? Who is this?
Yeah,
who's the official? It was a letter to the editor.
Mm, yeah, I've been seeing a lot of that from Express. From the Express, you see it on social media.
They
have these jarring headlines that make it, what?
Then you
read it and it sees an opinion piece.
Right, exactly. Yeah. But the opinion piece is only going in one direction. And I haven't seen any saying, this is why we should not mandate vaccines. So don't tell me it's just sensationalism because they're trying to capture your they want to get the click, so they put the most sense. Because you could put something in the opposite direction.
Yeah, and be just put something and then...
That's just as sensational. So they seem to think, I believe, that it's their role to promote vaccination. That's not... Because everybody feels like, hey, listen, I have to do my part to bring this thing. No, you could do that. You could do that in your personal life, but a newspaper shouldn't be doing that. A media house shouldn't be doing that. A doctor shouldn't be doing that. A medical expert who's being called on to just relay information, to provide the information that the government would be used to make their decisions and the public can use to understand the decisions being made. It's not your job to come up here and say, if I had to overstate things or understate things or whatever to frighten people a little bit. It's all in... Again, is the back to the parent and the child. Yeah. If I tell you a story about a boogeyman under your bed if you don't eat your vegetables, I mean it's in there, a boogeyman under your bed, but
well, okay, then you get strong,
right,
healthy,
right,
but then you grow up with trauma,
and you understand, and more importantly, as children, I am not your child, you understand, so.
The thing is, I wanted to touch on some other things quickly, as you're seeing, like with doctors and whatnot. And I'm hearing something a lot now. Obviously, we could be lying. I don't know, right? But I've heard from a few people within the last, I would say, month, where people went to their doctors. And this is obviously private doctors, right? I don't know if they operate in the public health care system as well, right? And they went and they were sick, right? They had... some COVID-like symptoms.
Flu-like symptoms.
Flu-like symptoms.
Yeah.
Which some are like what COVID consists of as well. And their doctors tell them, nah, that's just a flu tag going wrong.
Yeah.
And would advise them not to get tested.
Yeah.
I think that is real dangerous, you know.
Well, they could be trying to protect the health facility. They could be saying that... they may, if they have some connections with the public health facilities, they may also be advised to do that, to, you know, leave leave the wards for the people who are seriously sick.
But I ain't even talking about the wards, but at least if they get tested, they might. Because the thing is, when they tell people they have a regular flu, then these people would move around like normal. They would live their lives like normal. The doctor ain't telling them, well, they should quarantine, you know. Mm. No, the doctors, none of it have flu going around. Mm. And it's have this headache thing, and you're losing your sense of taste and smell, and whatever the case may be. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, they'll be tough over it. I think that things like that could help with the spread of what it is.
You're saying it would.
So I think that's a bit scary, and
I agree that it would help, but I could see why it might be the best thing to do. Listen, this is just anecdotal, of course, and I'm not any scientific study or anything like this, but there are a couple of people who I spoke to who were COVID positive, who said that their symptoms got worse as soon as they got the positive diagnosis. And I think that's mental. I think that's, you know, you have COVID, so now you feel like this is something that could kill me.
Mm-hmm.
And that seems to have some sort of physiological effect on people.
Okay, so let's get into our story, you know, right? My story, y'all. So it so happened that my younger daughter, she got ill, right? She started complaining of headaches, however.
Mm-hmm.
Everything seemed like just flu, like stuff. Then my wife started, because my wife was taking care of her and whatnot, and she wasn't feeling well, so my wife went and slept with her, and right? And then my wife started to feel ill as well.
Mm-hmm.
And so we made a decision, and she started to feel ill. Here, going on, you always stay so, I would stay separate, right? We weren't sure if it was COVID yet, but we were like, let's take this precaution at the end of the day, right? Even if it's not COVID, still I don't want to get sick, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because we both have jobs that we do have sick leave and whatever, right? So, like, all right, so let's stay so on that side of the house, I will stay on this side of the house, and we'll see how it goes. After a while, my wife started to feel better, and, well, my daughter, she felt better in about 3 days. Let's say 5 days.
That's long.
Right?
Mm.
Let's say 3 to 5 days, because her sickness started coming on the Tuesday. They went to get tested the Saturday, and by the Saturday, my daughter was fine. My wife, sickness started coming on the Thursday, and most of the issues went by the Saturday when they went to get tested.
Mm.
They went to get tested the Saturday, and here now, it took more than 3 weeks to get back a call from the testing facility, you know.
Yeah, actually lucky she get back a call. Right? I know plenty of people who never got a call.
Anyhow.
Regarding the results of the test status.
Right. Yeah. Now, she did make some calls and, you know, she knows a lot of people. One of the major reasons she went to get tested too is because the nature of her job is with interacting with people very closely, and she didn't want, obviously, to be spreading anything. So she said, it's best I go and check and find out. After some days where she was almost completely back to normal.
Yeah.
And she just said, like, yeah, okay, now, let me go and test. So we end up going to test privately, spend all our money.
Yeah.
I mean, fortunately enough for us that we have the money to spend on that.
Right.
Yeah. And then that test came back positive. So you're like, all right, cool. We just continue with what we were doing. They living and keeping separate. I stayed away from them, or whatever the case may be. We didn't test my daughter, though, because she was, like, real good at that point.
By that time,
yeah. So, as I said, my wife was mostly good at that point. It's just she was songing nasal, but she was good, right? So, we were like, all right, cool. This is what's going on. This is the situation, right? We had a lot of stuff there stocked up to start to take vitamin D. And I'm not advising anybody to take these things, but, right, vitamin D, zinc, K, and well, of course, vitamin C. You can probably see it on the camera. Yeah, Jameson, a good sponsor, boy, dog, boy. Ultra Farm, what we gonna do? Anyway, yeah. Then after the significant period of time passed, we say, like, cool, we need from the hospital, the facility, hospital, yeah. Right? The public facility, right? Testing facility. So you say, we're going and spend the money and do test again to see what's going on so she could get back to working. Right. And then we went and we spent our money again and it came back negative. And right. So she started back to work, however the case may be. Mm. And in my...
And you should mention as well that she did the... mandatory quarantine period. Eh?
Yeah, well, eventually, period of time waiting for right, and then right. Well, yeah, she had the time that they allotted to her because
you know people dotish now, because they might hear you talk and say, well, you feel all they went and do all the test, so you feel you could go is when you had to follow the public health authority's guidelines with respect to quarantining. So yeah,
right. But the thing is, so. At this point, I would say that the Trinidad and Tobago healthcare system has failed. And I think it has collapsed. Well, at least test inside of it. I think it...
I hear you, and I ain't gonna disagree. I ain't gonna say that it's in tip-top shape. But, I mean, that is something I never would have expected for them to have on the wraps. At all. Like, mass testing, getting back to people, and I never felt our healthcare system would ever be able to deal with that.
But so you see, the thing
not,
is...
So not in, it, on a surprise, that's the point
right,
that you make.
No, yeah. But the thing is, once again, these people would come on the TV and they would make these statements. If you're feeling something, go and get tested.
And then you go and they get tested and 3 weeks pass and...
Okay, so just now, I didn't see this part of it. They went, because as I said, we were separated, right? We kept apart. So they went to get tested, right? And they went and they reached, they were advised to reach 7 o'clock in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't open the facility till 11 mm-hmm. o'clock the day.
Mm-hmm. So right? You have people who are presumably symptomatic, who... And the reason why they're there to be tested is because they feel they might have COVID.
Right, they feel they might have COVID.
And the majority of them probably symptomatic. That's why they feel they might have COVID.
And you have them there for these long hours.
Yeah.
Right? Now, the next thing is, if somebody going to get tested, and then you have me waiting an hour or two, I'm not going through that. Especially somebody who don't have the money to go somewhere else. Right, I'm not going through this. See, that's me going through that. And they turn their back and they go and live their life. However they live their life, they jump back in a taxi. And these are the kind of things that are going on that nobody's talking about, obviously, and will... obviously not help with people getting tested. It would help with the spread. So I think we are doing more damage.
Well, we and this is a lot of countries in general, not just here in Trinidad and Tobago, because look at what happened with testing in the States.
Yeah, I don't know what happened across there though.
Well,
because they were testing good yesterday.
No, well, what they were they were talking about from the middle of the year, they were talking about making home testing kits more widely available so that as they begin to move away from lockdowns and kind of rely on people to make wise decisions, they would be able to do that because they'll have the home testing kits. So, and it was specifically supposed to be in place by the holiday time because what people want to know is, should I go and see my granny because, you know. And so if you have a home testing kit, it becomes easier to do that, easier to make your travel plans and so on. But they just didn't have the supply in place. The president is claiming that nobody expected for it to be such a priority because nobody saw Omicron coming.
Right. So is it that the testing kits that they had, the government had, is it that they stopped ordering them or they just didn't...
Well, I don't know what was the cause of the shortage, the inability to have stock.
That's why I'm trying to figure out how it ended up because...
Well, but you see, you were talking about they were testing all the time. They didn't... Home testing kits is not what they had.
I know. This is what I'm saying, but people were able to go there and get free tests when they were to come back to Trinidad. People who were in...
But that is not as... Now that Omicron is out, what is happening is that getting tested is a... is not as easy as it used to be, right, because mm-hmm. lots more people feel they have Omicron
right.
and want to get tested now. So in what they were claiming to do was, in preparation for that, have a large supply of home testing. No,
I understand
kits.
That, but yeah. I just trying to figure out, did they put a stop to the kits they were ordering for the government to have?
Well,
or is it that there's really so much more? They keep the normal flow coming if they were ordering, let me just say, 100,000 tests per state all the time, every month or every week.
Well, what the critics of the current administration's handling of the situation are claiming is that they did not make the necessary orders in order to secure the supply in time for the holiday season. And the president is claiming that they never would have been able to anticipate the demand they would have had because they would not have seen Omicron coming. But that Omicron was never supposed to have any impact
right.
on their supply, their securing of a supply of home testing kits. That's the claim. That's the argument that's being made against them. And the argument they are making, that Joe Biden is making essentially, is that, well, listen, I didn't see this Omicron thing coming. I didn't know they would have this massive demand for the home testing kits. We thought we had testing down pat. So that's the ins and outs. But in terms of coming back to Trinidad, listen, there's a lot of pretense, things that the government pretends they can control, but they're not really in we don't have the infrastructure to control it. We quite simply don't have the infrastructure in place to be able to provide that level of service that we claim we could provide. But don't say that on the
right
on the pulpit.
And exactly, and
on the pulpit, but you know, the podium.
But I mean, there's up really like they're preaching,
like they're preaching for free. Yes.
Yeah, so yeah. I mean, and I think this is not the first time I've had that experience, because I think when it was chicken gunya or one of them other weird things, right? And younger daughter had apparently, the big one, like, she don't get sick. Anyhow, she had fever and whatever. And we decided to, they were saying, you know, carry them to get whatever and to whatever.
But I remember in chikungunya, they were just giving you a diagnosis based on symptoms.
Right? But I think they had some shot or something, so you could have gotten at some point. I can't remember the chikungunya. One of these things that they were saying that you could go and, right? And they went and stayed in the hospital from, I think, maybe about 9 o'clock in the morning till about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And then they tell them, they needed a specific testing for whatever it was. And they're like, well, we really do have that test here, and all run out after keeping them there nearly all day. And you listen to them talk, you listen to the minister talk. Just go on.
Even in
the early of COVID, when my younger daughter, she got sick in the early stages, and she they took her to the one in Aruka, the clinic, and he said, like, okay, we come to test to see if it's COVID.
Yeah, yeah.
And they was like, she was in contact with anybody with COVID. We don't know.
Yeah.
Well, and she was sick, right? She had fever and everything.
Yeah.
Well, you're going on. Give her this. And well, if she is in contact with anybody with COVID, you give me a show call her to tell you.
What? But, I mean, I hear you, but you should be aware that, you know, that story you gave about the long wait time and then you're disappointed. That only happened here.
No, I say no. My thing is, you're advising people to go. Mm. And the thing is, there's nothing wrong with having a long wait time if you get through. But
no, but not get through. I didn't personally experience it, but I saw that firsthand when I was in Canada. A friend of mine, who, while I was there, he thought he had alcohol poisoning, and he went to the emergency room the evening. That was like 9 o'clock, because he was out and he started to feel unwell. And my friend was saying should I go with him, but he said he go on his own or whatever, and he left. And then he came, she saw him the next morning, and he was like, he left there at like 4 o'clock in the morning. No one had attended to him, but he started to feel better, so he left.
All right. You know? That's still okay. My thing is, those times they come to get a particular test or to get a particular drug or whatever the case may be, and you don't even have it, and I'm a waiter now, but because you could have tell me that when I reach.
Yeah.
You could have said, well, based on what's going on here, it's about 6 months, it's about 10 people who want it. Mm-hmm. So you're going to get you. So you could probably want to try something else.
Yeah.
You understand what
I'm saying? But the point I'm making is, if it could happen with just being seen by a doctor for them to examine you properly and diagnose you, you think it wouldn't be happening with things like that? With testing? You feel they would have some facilities in the public healthcare system in some of these first world countries where... You know, you go and you think, oh, well, I'll get through. And you wait for hours and hours and never get what they tell you is going to get. All I'm saying is, don't feel that that'll happen in them big, nice, so-called first world places. I think we should give an honorary mention to the THA elections.
Oh.
As a story from 2021 that we didn't get a chance to talk about.
Boy, honorary mention, boy.
Yeah, I think that's probably the biggest, well, in my opinion, the biggest or the most impactful story thing that happened outside of COVID in Trinidad and Tobago this year. Well, it happened in Tobago specifically, but yeah. And we didn't get a chance to cover it because we...
Yeah.
Yeah.
You had
your COVID trials.
So, here we're going on with that, right? I have always said that Tobagonians... they are more willing to take the risk when it comes to voting. I would also say that I think they are more mature politically.
You think they're more mature politically?
Yeah. When I say mature, I think that they're willing to stand and make decisions. And
but you don't think it's just because there is they don't have the race?
Well, that too.
One color in here, text here. So, there's not the tribal allegiance that will stop people from making a change.
Right. But I would admit that as well.
Yeah, I think that's the only thing that makes a difference.
But I mean, when it had the NAR became, NAR had some strength there, and they were going up against PNM, and you understand what I'm saying? Mm. They still decided to make the choice. Based on whether they made decisions on, I don't know what it is.
You know what I'm saying is the reason why I suspect that what you're saying is that if they see and things not going the way they want it to go, they're not afraid to make a change. I think that happens. They're more prone to doing that than here in Trinidad and Tobago, here in Trinidad, because there is no tribal allegiance to any particular party because everybody is the same color.
Everybody look right, yeah. Right?
Everybody's the same. So there's no... So in Trinidad, you would find...
So you wouldn't say that's a degree of maturity, even though it stems from they just being a particular way? Because I think because we have the two, it forces us to be sort of immature in our decisions.
Well, I think it would be it would have been a sign of political maturity if they made decisions based on well, I guess you could say the fact that they're doing it based on quote unquote results makes it more rational as opposed to doing it based on race. So yeah, I guess in that from that perspective, I guess you could say yes, they're more politically mature. But I think they only are that way. They're not a special breed of people. They only are that way because...
Their circumstance.
Yeah, their circumstance doesn't... So in Trinidad, people may want to make a change, but because the hair texture and skin color thing is so important, they won't make the change because they're afraid that giving the next party the reins would mean devastation on their part. So I just don't want to... I shouldn't say don't want to make the impression, but... I got the impression like you were feeling like, you know, that like they're generally more witted than Trinidadians, but I think it's not really that.
I think they kind of, when I say witted, when I say witted exactly, where,
like Trinidadians are these, we have completely backward ways of thinking when it comes to politics, but they are, you know, much more astute. And they sit and they discuss matters in a rational manner.
I wouldn't say as far as that. But what I'll say is, I think because of how small it is, and they have reached to the people that they are voting for in most situations, in most instances, I think they are more willing and able to put those people feet to the fire. right?
Yeah.
And I think that as well helps. Mm-hmm. You understand? So when I spoke to people who, because my wife has some clients from Tobago, a significant amount of clients, strange, but right? So I was asking them when the election was coming up, you know, what's going on, how you feel. And so much of them will give you stories about how they know all these people, how they knew these people personally. Now.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
On both sides.
Yeah.
And
It's a small island. Yeah. For those who are not from Trinidad and Tobago, it's a place with about, 30,000?
I can't remember how much is that right now.
I know it's a wide range because it's actually double, but it's between 30,000 and 60,000.
Right.
And I don't believe it's 60. I mean, it's closer to 30.
Yeah. And they would tell you, well, listen, I know this one and this one who going up against this one. Mm-hmm. And this one is a better person. This one, when my wall had fallen down in the back of my house before there was even in politics, this one come with their friends and they help it pay it back up. Mm-hmm. And we think and we drink our beer and we think whatever. And, you know, they would say, but this one, you know, that one with a Benita was just passed and hey, if all fall along, boy. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, they're now voting based on actually knowing the people and what, I guess, in the people's hearts, if you want to put it like that, some of them.
60,000.
Yeah. So I guess...
That's my point. That had nothing to do with who should run a... I shouldn't elect you to head the Tobago Health House of Assembly because you helped me when my wall fall down. You understand what I'm saying? So when we say more politically mature, you know, that's the kind of thing I mean. Like, what difference does that make? He could be a real helpful person but incompetent. You understand what I'm saying? Or he might be competent, but if he has chosen a lot of incompetent people with him. So there are a lot of things that had that. And when I say that, it's not to say that very many places are politically mature, you know. Because if you speak to the, I can't remember who used to say it, but they used to say if you want to see the flaws of democracy, just talk to the average voter, and you realize when you see what goes on in their brain as to why they're picking somebody, it just completely is detached from where it should be. The important things don't matter. So things like what you're mentioning, that is why I was like putting a pause on the whole idea.
Well, you see, the thing is, and I understand why you put a pause on it, but I could still say that is a way better reasoning.
Right. Okay. Yeah.
To vote, and where does he about here?
Well, I mean, here what it is fear. It's fear of the other. Is the fear and hatred. Fear of the other side getting in power and you being kept out of any opportunities, and hatred of people of a different skin tone and
because hair texture. The thing is, it's one thing for somebody to help you when it's not their money spending or on government time and this is what they had to do. But it's the next thing for somebody who doing it of their own time and of their own pocket. Mm-hmm. And I'm not saying that that person should be elevated. Mm-hmm. But what I'm saying is that person in the group where we are coming across. I think I might prefer to take my chances with that person. You understand?
So what you think is the... What do we take away from the election? For those who don't know, the PNM who were in charge in Tobago, House of Assembly for the past 20 something years.
Yeah, 21 years.
Right. They got walloped at the polls. How much did it be? 14-1?
Yeah.
Right. So they got, from a constituency standpoint, they were walloped, right? Now, in many cases, it does sound a little bit more, it sounds a little worse than it actually was, because in many of these cases...
They were very close.
Each constituency, the difference between your constituency was like 10 people and 5, you understand what I'm saying? So, it does make it sound like if the PNM, you know, lost all support, but it really isn't. It's probably still half and half close to half and half when you add it up. But the point is they lost the control of the House of Assembly. What does that mean, if anything, do you think?
I've been saying this to a lot of these people that I don't think it means much, because with PNM being at the helm of central government, and in my opinion, I think they could be a bit vindictive. Mm-hmm. I think they I mean,
you mean for, or you mean for the people of Tobago, yeah, specifically? Okay,
right. And I don't think they would really go out of their way to help, because even when PNM was in charge of the Tobago Auto Assembly, they were complaining that central government wasn't doing enough.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think it's going to be worse even for that. In terms of, can we say, when you see something like that, no, I think that's how Tobago does operate. I think, as I said in the past...
They haven't done it for 20-something years.
Well, true. But I also think that one of the reasons for that is when you have somebody like Watson Duke involved and majority of Tobago's population being workers of the THA and being basically government employees, he knows how to talk to government employees.
Mm-hmm.
He knows how to... I don't say that.
I think we should.
He knows how to talk to them. And I think he spoke to them in a way that he knows how to talk to government employees, and they came out and did what they needed to do.
Mm.
Now we have to wait and see. I think eventually we'll see some bacchanal between him and Farley. I think Farley
being he's the deputy leader of the party.
Of the party,
but he's the elected member to head the Tobago House of Assembly. Yeah.
Yeah. And so I think we'll see some issues with that, because at the end of the day, PDP is kind of Watson Duke baby and Watson Duke party. But now to have somebody else kind of leading, I don't know Farley personally. I think I would have come across him a couple of times in those things we used to go and do in Tobago, right? He seems like he wants to change the political landscape a bit.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if I could say the same for
Watson Duke.
Watson Duke. I think Watson Duke, he just like what the political landscape is. He talk shit, throw talk, bullshit, and no real sustainable policies.
Right.
So I think I just had to wait and see how it unfolds.
All right. Well, at this stage, I think it's best we get into the predictions for next year one time, because it will lead. I will start with this one as we're talking about this. This is what I was trying to go with the question about the THA. So what you predict for the PNM in 2021? In 2022, sorry, in the coming year. And by that, what I mean, what you predict. What I lead into with the Tobago House of Assembly question is, do you believe that the PNM is beginning to come under an inordinate amount of pressure? And if you believe that, do you think it will have any... And I'm saying this because all throughout the year, we've been kind of saying... Well, not throughout the year, because you haven't been doing this that much. But you know what I mean? We've been kind of saying that the PNM's position in this country is safe because of how ineffective the opposition is. So I'm asking, does this shatter that? Do you think the 2022 could be a pressure cooker year for them?
No, I think they're still safe. Because we can't judge Trinidad and Tobago based on what went on in Tobago.
True, but it is worth mentioning that we had a rerun of the Tobago House of Assembly elections, because the one that was run before, when it was constitutionally mandated, ended in a 6-6 tie. And we went from that
to
the PNM almost being wiped out of Tobago.
Well, yes, yes, still
in the space of a year.
Well, the thing is... But you know, admitted it, you know, that it was still real close.
Right.
It just trickled across. We didn't check it. Plenty of them. We're not about two or three or four votes and that kind of thing.
Right.
So it's not to say, I mean, yes, the end result seems like they get washed, but it was still very close. So it took a few hundred people.
Right. Probably 1,000-something people. To shift the balance of power.
Right? So, which is...
But that's a significant number when you're talking about an island with that
minuscule population. But the thing is, here, once again, we'll have to depend on the marginals, right?
No, okay, listen. 2022 is not an election year.
Right.
So I know the PNM is not going to lose power in 2022. But what I'm saying is, when I say a pressure cooker year, are we seeing the PNM, and I'm saying the PNM as if the PNM is unique or special, but I mean it, they are the ones in government now. Are we going to see in 2022 cracks starting to form in the public support for the party?
I don't think
in
so.
In general, across
Trinidad. I think people have their feelings when it comes to COVID and what happened and what shouldn't happen.
Because I think that's a big, I think that's what made the difference between the first election and the rerun. I think there's a souring of people's sentiment when it comes to the PNM because of the COVID situation.
You see, if he had talked that mandate for government workers before that election, then you would see. You see the 4 votes and 10 votes and it would have been more.
Well, right. So 2022, we seeing.
They're
planning to put this thing in place. I don't know if it's going to happen, but.
Nah, I don't think all that is talk. And I think, because as I was explaining to somebody today, I think right now is the majority of the country, of the people who could get vaccinated, are vaccinated in Trinidad and Tobago, right? Right? This is a new majority.
Eligible, yeah.
Right?
People are eligible.
And I think he just said what he think he needed to be said, what needed to be said, because people want him to say it. So I think he's still playing the political game, and I think he would be okay. I think, especially if Omicron comes, spreads, and everything starts to calm down, I think he'll be okay throughout the rest of this year. I think you'll see the little drama now, but everything will be okay.
No, listen, I agree, you know. I agree that this public service thing, and I have a firm belief it's not getting off the ground, right? Not because it can't cross constitutional hurdles. I just don't believe that is something that he actually wants to do, right? And I agree that it's just a talk to scare, to see how many, because, I mean, especially the short period of time you're talking about here, I don't know how many of them will be able to meet the requirements before the time you're promising to follow them. So you're expecting a battle. And I think the battle is what you're hoping for, and in the battle you could convince and frighten some people and so on and so forth. So I agree with that. But there is a possibility that it could go left. There is a possibility that they could stick to their guns, and there is a possibility that a legal challenge could, because once a legal challenge is posed and then it's decided upon by somebody in the industrial court or wherever that it's okay to go ahead with it, how are you going to not go ahead with it after? Because you say you believe in the policy, your AG say he believe in the policy and he could back the policy and he could this, and he ain't backing down to the unions. So it is a possibility that it could arise. And I think you're discounting the fact that things could get really sour. Things are already sour.
Nah, but I think they are politicians and they will continue to bow to public pressure. They would act up. You know them, when it come down to, the man who does make a real noise when it come down to fighting time, but as soon as hands start to pass, he just kind of get quiet or he just kind of melt in the whole scene. That's what this do.
My thing with this mandate with the PSA, and again, we should explain for people who may not know, the government of Trinidad and Tobago has announced that they're going to be making all public service bodies safe zones. So therefore, only vaccinated members of staff will be allowed to get paid to work, right?
If not, you just cannot come out to work and you cannot get paid.
You can't get
paid. You wouldn't be fired, but you just can't come out to work.
And you can't enter the building and you wouldn't be paid, right? The amount of grand charging that's taking place, I think it's going to be hard to back down. And I think they might be backing themselves into a corner where they go look.
I think they want to play for that legal battle. Let the union step up. And I think they hoping that if it have to go to court, the whoever going to say no, you can't do it.
Well,
the thing is we tried, but the court say we can't do it. And the unions put up this fight. And so the thing is we tried to save all the rest of all who frightened, but the court say we can't.
I don't know why they would be so confident that would happen, though. I don't think they should want that to go to the court. I would have thought that it would have been a negotiation. They would have been a lot less antagonistic when it came to the unions from the beginning of this thing. Because I think if it goes to court, I don't think the unions will be protected. I don't think that the decisions will come down in the way that, if that's what they're hoping, I think they could run into a monkey pants, because from all of the legal, the luminaries who coming out and talking, everybody, yes, well, there's a constitutional, you know, and obviously they don't have anything to do with the case, and, you know, it's up to the judges who are to talk, but, and I think the head of the industrial court, they said that she wouldn't be allowed to, I shouldn't say that because I'm not sure, but I could be wrong, but I believe that, you know, she would have to recuse herself from any of the presiding over the matters because she already gave her opinion
right on it,
on the situation. So I don't know that it could necessarily be, you know, that they should be very confident that the court, unless they're putting things in place, you know, which, you know, you don't want to suggest that they're doing. I think it might be problematic. If I was them, I wouldn't want it to go to that stage. I would want it to have an amicable resolution beforehand. And
yeah, but after you boss up your mouth, so
right,
you have no room for that.
Well, that's what I'm saying. So this is why I feel like they're putting themselves in a situation. I don't want to see it happen. I don't want to see nobody lost their work, right? But with the comments I hear in and the way the AG is talking, and I mean, I haven't heard the Prime Minister himself talk about it since, but they seem to be not in a position to, they're not putting themselves in a situation where they'll have very much leeway. So if the court doesn't come to the rescue of the workers, then they will have to implement their policy. And, you know, by that time, the only thing that would give them an out is if the pandemic comes to an end.
Right.
Right. Which is not going to come to an end in 2022.
Well, right. So for one, I think they will start by having an extension, first of all.
Right,
I think
the
15th or the middle of January that they were suggesting, I think they're going to have to start by extending that.
Right.
And they'll probably extend it into somewhere into February.
Right.
March. Mm-hmm. Right? Or the end of February, early first of March kind of thing.
Yeah.
And
yeah, I think they will definitely have that, yeah.
Right? And then I think they're playing for the court to get involved and be on the side of I think that's what they're playing for. I could be wrong. I think that's what they're playing for. The court to be on the side of the employees.
Yeah.
And then they could say, well, it's the court fault. And this way you could kind of appease the people who were supporting it, talking about mandatory. Mm-hmm. And you could appease them. I say, we try, but it's the court.
Mm-hmm.
And then they could still get to the people who don't want to get vaccinated. They could still do what they want to do and live their life how they want to live their life. And they say, all right, cool, you're done there. And
yeah, yeah. I mean, I honestly, I remember the day you called me. I think we were talking and I doing a cutoff or something. But that is the point I was making. I don't think that it's going to happen. But as I say, and the union songing real kind of mousy, like, you know, and some of them talking. I was talking to a police officer the other day and I was asking him, so what is going on? And he said, well, boy, people do, you know, if they interfere with a man. But he's one of them who's not vaccinated and unwilling to get vaccinated. But, you know, he started to say, well, boy, you know, when they start to play with a man bread, you know, so a couple officers already, that I know already went and take the job and the first job and the this and that. And he said, well, I said, what about the unions? He said, well, boy, them talking.
Yeah, you know, really somebody. Oh, yeah, because I have a cousin who, you know, who works the Antec, and I was asking him, well, what's going on? He said, well, boy, some men decide they go in and on.
Yeah.
Some men say, well, boy, anytime they play mad, they say Trinidad will end up with some blackouts now.
Right.
So I said, but what are the union saying? He said, Roger? He said, what are we hearing from Roger? I told Roger starting to buy to buy plant.
The heritage.
Yeah.
From the heritage company. Said, yeah.
Roger starting to buy plant. Roger ain't selling me. I said, well, boy, alright.
And he was saying that boy, asking what the union, he said, boy, them talking about negotiating for back pay, so them trying to use it as a lever. So like them willing to concede, yeah, we could, but give me something for the vaccination. Right.
I saw somebody pause a video talking about that, calling Rowley on her, saying a woman, I don't know if you saw her.
No.
She's part of someone in them party and them, and she's saying that we still working on 2013, but you want to talk about vaccine?
Yeah.
Sort out the back pay first.
Right, right.
And
yeah,
then
yeah,
we go talk about vaccine.
Yeah. So them not, they not even standing up for the basic human rights and bodily autonomy kind of thing. They're like, they're trying to use it to get more money for the, it's like, what? So all of these things really frightened me. As I thought you'd have seen a much more vigorous response from the unions and from the people in the public service, number one. And then I thought I'd have seen a softer response from the government, but none of these. So we seem to be heading for this thing happening. And I think that, along with the fact that the economy is not getting any better and people are growing, the frustration is growing. People have not been able to live their lives the way they normally live their lives. So I think the growing discontent, I think it could be a... Now, as I say, it's not an election year, so I'm not saying they're going to vote out tomorrow. And I don't think they'll have a snap election or they're going to get that bad. But I think that there could be a lot of pressure put on the government come next year.
No, but I mean, even if, because this is how I see it, I think even if they get some degree of pressure now, they have 3 more years from next year to fix whatever wrongs and people to forget whatever it is, and they'll be okay. So even if I get some pressure, okay, OLFX and okay over it.
Well, I mean, no, but pressure could mean they're making some concessions in certain regards. It could mean, it might mean shake up in the cabinet. It might mean, you know, somebody might begin to rear their head to take the leadership of the party. You understand? So that is what I mean. So I mean, the cracks could start to form, and we could see some.
I think the PNM machine is a somewhat well-oiled machine, and I think, I'm not saying they form a good government at home.
I know.
I think they tend to manage their affairs pretty well. See, if it was the UNC and this drama, God, well, I think somebody would have killed somebody inside there. I think somebody would have committed suicide if they had started to feel that kind of pressure. But I think the PNM, you know what it's called? I think it's an institution or something they call itself. You know, to make it seem like they are not just a political party, right?
Right.
I think that institution is, I think is right, so for what see. It is a great one. I think they would be able to hold off and manage the affair as well.
So you say 2022 will be same as usual for the PNM?
Yeah.
Right. I disagree. So we'll come back at the end of 2022.
Yeah, and see. And
we'll, I know there's a kind of difficult thing to, because we could probably end up in an argument about whether or not pressure did start to bust by, because...
Well, I mean, certain things must, you must see certain things. If at the end of the day, they had to change the Minister of Health and because of certain decisions
made.
You know, someone saying...
I think you could see them kind of things happening.
And change the AG and, you know, all them kind of things.
Yeah, I could see some of that happening. I feel so. Right, so the obvious thing now is, what do you think will happen with the pandemic itself?
I was hopeful for the Omicron to spread.
Come and done the dance.
Come and, not done it, but at least, you know, people just have to live with it like the cold. Like, you know, and well, we see in places like England, they reach a stage of putting you on like 6 to 7 days quarantine if you test positive. And they testing you on the 6th day and the 7th day, and if you're negative in those days, we could go back into regular flow of things. I think the CDC put out something about if you're asymptomatic
and you're fully vaccinated.
And you're fully vaccinated after five days you could go back out masked. I don't know how they're managing that one. But okay, whatever. And I do think that's something we'll see here though, but not that one, because I mean,
we're shortening the period. Well,
I can see shortening the period, but I don't see the if you test positive and you're asymptomatic, after 5 days you go back out masked. I don't think I would see that here. I think we will see, because once the Omicron reaches and starts to spread, and people start to have to be away from work, they can't afford for too much people to be away from work for 21 days. That will cripple the country for sure, for sure. And so they will have to start to drop it, and make different concessions and whatnot and say, well, okay, I guess. Right? So we'll see how it goes. But that is my hope. My hope is that the Omicron comes. People can track it. People realize it's not that bad. But they're saying it look like it could be about 10% less. Or no, not 10%. 10% deaths of the people who would contract it. Only 10% of the people might die. No, 10%.
No variant had that. Yeah,
10% of the amount of people that was normally dying. So
right. I think it's hospitalizations is 10% of the it's causing a 10%.
Alright, let me put it like this. Because I think I confused myself while I was saying it. So you're going to see a reduction, right? I think a 70% reduction in hospitalization and 90% reduction in deaths.
Right.
That is
right.
A better way to put it.
Yes. I believe that is what I heard.
Right. So it's like a 70% reduction in hospitalization and 90% reduction in deaths. I think a 90% reduction in deaths could look pretty good for us. Obviously, we don't want anybody to die, but if we could move from 20 and we could come down to, well, 10% or 20 is like a piece of a person. Mm-hmm. But if we could, the numbers start to drop that significant, I think we could see some major events, something happening in the August time. I think we could see life almost as normal once the Omicron comes and at least takes up at least 85% of the spread here.
Mm-hmm.
I think we could go back to living like normal.
2% at 10% at 20 is 2. That's it?
Well, that's not good. You can't imagine the math. Ten.
Yeah.
Well, whatever.
Yeah, there's two people.
That's not. 10% of 100 is 1. You see? No,
10% of 100 is 10.
Right, yeah. Right, yeah. Good boy, yeah, boy.
I pause myself.
Yeah, okay,
let me make sure I'm not seeing something wrong before we get to that. Right, yeah. So, yeah.
10% 2, right.
So, right, it would be 2. So, not half a person, but 2. Yeah, right. But anyway, right. I get where you're coming from. Right. I believe that with respect to the pandemic, I believe that it will be declared over in the first quarter or half of 2023.
Mm-hmm.
I think it will be virtually over in most of the world, not here, but I think it'll be virtually over in most of the world by about April. I'm gonna say virtually over. Now, it's gonna take a while before anybody's gonna declare it done and everybody's because there are lots of people who will not want it to end.
Mm-hmm.
Right? People might believe that, but there are quite a number of people who I don't mean they want people to continue to die, but they certainly don't want to release the reins of power and start to say, hey, yeah, man, or they're not motivated to let you go back to life as normal, right? Some of them because they like just pulling the strings of power, and some of them because they don't want to be the ones to say go back to normal and then something happen. So everybody could be like, oh, I don't know, I ain't sure. So they'll dawdle around for some time with that. I will go back with my prediction from 2021. We will have a carnival in the summer period. We will have a carnival that involves fetting with everybody, not vaccine parties. And it would be we would have some version of carnival before 2022. Two is out. I shouldn't say someone.
Let me not
leave it to someone.
The thing is, I think that could cause some drama. So let's see how it goes, because you remember they were hinting to that for next year, right? Based on how things look.
Mm-hmm.
And speaking to some people from Barbados and some people from Grenada, they already upset about the thought of that.
That's your business. I couldn't care less.
Yeah, but I mean, I think all the parties involved and the CARICOM people, and I think they will all have to have some sort of discussion.
Why?
I mean, they don't need to care, but I think...
I mean, you have yours just like always having all of the rest of them just have it in the summer period. So...
But we know what they're saying is it could cripple the situation with artists, with them hiring artists from here to, you know, to beef up their festivities and, you know.
And but I think we could be have a big argument that our own could be affected by that because Grenadians ain't going to leave. If Spice Mass is a week before Trinidad, they ain't going to have Grenadian artists ain't going to come here and spend a month before.
Yeah, but like, real dog. Like, real dog. And I love Grenadian artists. But we could survive and we would be fine without the Grenadian artists or the Bayesian artists.
But I don't feel so now.
Yeah, I understand.
I don't feel so.
I understand what you're saying.
But no, we're going to have something. But what I'm saying, I think our own will be more, at the current state of soca now, I think ours will be worse for wear without them than theirs will be without us.
Right, I understand that. But they don't look at it like that because a lot of Grenadians, they're so accustomed to their artists and they love their artists, but they also love to have that difference number. And to not have it, I think, you know, some of the promoters, probably not the Grenadian people, some of the promoters will feel like they're being robbed or they, you know. And
yeah, I think the promoters might argue, but I don't think the people of Grenada would feel. Am I saying that they wouldn't want to see Trinidadian artists? No, but what I'm saying is, if you tell them, well, because of how this thing running, we ain't going to sell a Trinidadian artist this year. Okay, so be it, we'll jab. And they go have a time like they normally do. And if it means that we might have some issues with respect to, and when I say have a carnival, it don't have to be a carnival season again. You know, it don't have to be like, well, we signed 2 months of fair time.
It's Chinese now, dog. No, anytime, I mean, they give them the clearance. It's been a carnival for 6 months in Trinidad, I'm telling you.
Well, listen, what I'm saying is, while we're planning it, if you had to plan it and administrate it, then you simply, okay, listen, it's a 2 week thing. We condensing it into 2 weeks and we having a street parade, but we didn't go. Yeah. we don't have to have all the bacchanal that we normally have. Because I think we'll still try to have something in February. I think they will try to have something that they will call carnival, that would be the cultural thing or whatever. But I think later on in the year we will have what we will miss in February, which will be a street party and a series of parties. I think we're gonna have that. And I couldn't care less. I ain't even dying for carnival, and I ain't even saying this because I ready for a fete. I couldn't care less either. But if we decide to do that, the last thing I would think about is how Grenada and Barbados and St. Vincent or St. Lucia feel about that. It's a pandemic, but you know, we'll go back to normal next year. Just calm yourself.
Man.
So
next year they start to get worried, you know, because next year they only like this August thing, and I really decided to move all the whole thing to August and mash up everybody.
Well, boy, I think they should feel like they have the advantage in that, you know, because in recent years they seem to be the ones more able to please the visitors when they arrive for the carnival. But I know I don't want to get into that.
Yeah, long talk, because that is a whole different complicated. But so. My thing is, that's all I waiting to see the Omicron, how they treated it. Hopefully it comes and it does what they perceive it to do.
No, but the problem is they aren't talking like that. That's the issue. If you listen to the people here talk about Omicron, I mean, the few little clips I've seen and the things I've read in the newspaper, they seem to be just as frightened of Omicron.
Yeah, I know. I see people posting on social media as well.
And you would, you know, again, you don't, I'm not saying that we should have a spread, we should let it spread, we don't know. Because people still say, well, we don't know, and we don't know. And in Trinidad, especially, where we have the healthcare capacity being tested at present, even if 10% of the people who were going to the hospital with Delta, going to the hospital with Omicron, that would just add more issues to the, you know, more fuel to the fire, whatever. So I'm not saying they should do that. But they aren't acting like, and it's not just Trinidad and Tobago. Much of the world isn't acting.
But one of the biggest, one of the people who was operating the harshest, which was
Australia. Yeah.
Well, as Australia, like.
Yeah.
Yeah, boy. Yeah.
But they would say they did that because they achieve over 90% vaccination.
Yeah.
Right? So they would say they feel comfortable essentially saying, well.
Well, I mean, in the next few weeks, there's going to be the true tester because you're going to be putting them against South Africa, who had 40% vaccination compared
40%?
To
40%? Oh, no, they're 20 something percent.
I think 40% one dose at least.
No, I don't think so. No, I think it's closer to, I think 30%.
Oh, all right. So yeah. Much less vaccination.
Yeah. So nowhere near.
And so that is what they're going to be measuring very soon compared to Australia, a country with 90%.
Yeah.
How the Omicron affects.
Right.
You know.
Exactly.
And we're waiting to see how that turns out.
I think it will come to an end, not necessarily because of Omicron. I think it will come to an end because it's only so long that you could put up with this. And we will have to start to behave normal very soon. And if we don't, we will really find ourselves running off of an economic cliff. These children can't stay home for much longer. I saw something today or some proposal for how they restart in school and primary school children. They're still keeping them home until third term. Mm-hmm. From one to three, they want to start cycling them in person from February. The rest will continue going to school like they do now. But there's another term for children who not in standard five in primary school. This can't continue for much longer. At some point in time, the wave of infections in Trinidad will begin to fizzle out naturally, unless Omicron come now and
push it back up.
Push it, and make it crazy. But it would have begun to fizzle out on its own. And I just think we can't do it much longer. We cannot do it much longer. And the longer we wait, the more acclimated to what is happening that people become. Because there are people who just simply, they hear to do something and it just doesn't make a difference anymore. Yeah, yeah. They're just living the life. The only thing that's stopping them from doing certain things is because they're not allowing it. But if they allow it tomorrow, they'll go and fed. They don't care. You know what I mean? They've, as far as they're concerned, I've given enough of my life to COVID. It's time to live. So I just think jump high, jump low. We will have to get back to normal at some point in time. And I think the public's perception of COVID is going to have to change. And so for that reason, I think we're going to be done with that. And I say, in terms of declaring the pandemic over, I think that won't come until next year. But I think we'll be done with that. There's one other thing I wanted to get your prediction on, and it's slipping my mind now. The economy.
The thing is, I'm seeing the economy falling apart right now as we speak. So I think we are in for some hard times in 2022. We're seeing some degrees of inflation. And I think by the end of 2022, we'll have... I think it'll be rough.
You still feel the PNM could go through 2022 like nothing cool or
breezy. Yeah, but you see, because you have enough things to point to.
People don't care about that.
Nah, when you talk
to people seeing debt outside too, and they're still not pleased with what the people who are upset with Dr. Rowley in Tobago to run the PNM. What they could point to that he was doing that nowhere else was doing. Upset. The people.
Now we might are telling Tobago might have been a different situation because of the conversations, the way I think they reach them, with a lot of public service talk, a lot of this money that they owe you, we giving you that back, and they reach them with a lot of them petty things.
I think that when people start to get hungry, they don't care. Now the sycophants will always, the Balize waivers could be like, the defenders of the party, especially those in the middle class, the bourgeoisie, whose money not being affected, they will be like, just look at the other places in the world. But the groundsmen, who form the grassroots of the support for the party, they don't want to hear nothing, but they don't care if inflation is triple the amount in the States. I can't eat bread, man. Because remember, you've already gotten these people into the concept that you are the person to take care of them, right? So when they can't get work, it's your fault. When they can't afford food, it's your fault. And if food prices skyrocketing, you had to step in and sort that out. You had to either give me the money to buy the food or you control the prices, however you had to control the prices, right? And then there's always say that with the grocery, you go, step in and put in price control. Then they are going to say they don't care if every other country in the world experiencing it.
Well, I don't know. We got to wait to see. Because I would admit I don't know much people like that. Personally,
mm-hmm.
I mean, to see, you know, how I could predict that they would operate.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the people who I know, they are the types of people that if you could explain to them that you're going on, it's you're going on across the world, the shipping situation, the weather situation, whatever the case may be, they would say, well, boy, look what's going on across the world.
Well, I think those are people who are looking for excuses for the PNM, but or for the government in general. But I listen, the thing is, ultimately, a hungry man is a hungry man.
Mm.
And I think it could get so bad that people will have no... You see, the government has been banking on that whatever economic fallout comes from COVID, everybody will just blame the virus. And therefore, they can't... you know, nobody going to blame me. I can't blame me. The virus come. I didn't bring the virus. And there will be people who will be saying that. There will be people like who you're talking about there. And the, as I said, defenders of the PNM. Excuse me. As the first thing they go say, oh, God, thing. So tell my country in the world where they didn't go through now. But the grung, not having that. Because they ain't gonna care at this stage. I don't care, solve it. So I've got to eat. I'd eat. You understand? And even if they don't feel it's your fault, it reach here. It's your responsibility to sort
fix
it out.
Yeah. Well, but I just had to wait and see how it goes. I think, as I say, based on people I know, I think PNM might be able to weather the storm, but...
And you see they're coming to outlaw Susu. So...
No. Well, I think we saw they was drafting when they draft up that a while ago.
Well, they tabled it recently in Parliament, so they no getting around it. So when the hard times start to hit next year, do you even feel you could go and knock up a little thing and start to run your DSS again?
So
it's problems. I want to make some predictions for the podcast.
Talk to me, right?
So I predict that by mid-year, we will have a bigger, well, not maybe not bigger, but a more reliable studio space, right? And we plan to, this is not a prediction per se, it's an announcement of plans. We plan to start getting some guests in because we're looking to make things bigger and better
in 2022. In 2022. We're in tune for a while. You know, we started to pull it together late in 2021.
Yes.
So, you know, we're going to continue doing the work and trying to put things in place. Yeah, that's the cats and I'm behaving bad.
You see, and we will be in a space free of the cats.
Yeah. So, with that being said, obviously, podcasting in Trinidad is something that will take a while before it's monetized. So, in terms of studio space, if you had to rent a studio space, you know, let's see how all those things work out. But definitely, there's something we want to do so we could record at any time, a more convenient spot for people to come, a better setup, better look, and everything. So,
improved aesthetics, maybe improved audio quality.
And like improve the audio quality more than this, right?
Well, I said maybe. That one said, I didn't say for sure. Maybe we might get
more cameras,
slightly better mics.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? We could start improve camera angles. But most importantly, we want to continue doing this for you guys. For you guys, this is a labor of love. You know, we clearly don't money. We haven't been able to monetize it, and you know, I don't know about you, but I am not too focused on that. The only reason I would want to monetize it is because I want to improve it.
Right.
But it's not at this point in time, I'm not focused on gain and on getting money from this. This is really for us to air out some issues in ways that, you know, other people don't.
Yeah, to present an alternative perspective.
Right.
Yeah. And so that's what we're doing right now.
Mm-hmm.
And as you were saying, you know, the money part of it for us is not to, at this stage, it's not really to fill our pockets.
Blood clot.
But is to obviously improve and make the show bigger and better.
Right.
Higher producers and things. Hey, hey.
And be able to avoid bombs dropping in Baghdad. You know what I mean? But yeah, So that is it for 2021, boy.
Yeah.
That is it.
Let me get ready for 2022.
Yeah. Bigger, better, brighter. And I mean, I'm not trying to sound corny and like motivational speakerish, but I really would, I mean, it's something I am adopting and have been adopting for a while, but again, more serious about it now, and I hope that the listeners do this as well, is to live in, start living with intention.
Mm-hmm.
So we have a way that we kind of just allow life to come at us. And so we always say we want next year to be bigger and better, but then we don't take the actions that will make that more likely to take place. And obviously, there are always things out of your control. You know, no day is given. I could go to sleep tonight and not wake up tomorrow. So there are these things outside of our control, but we have to focus on the things within our control so that we are to make sure that, listen, if 2022 is not bigger and better than 2021, is because, you know, something completely outside of my control, you know, came into play, and you know, you couldn't get that done.
Well, I mean, at the end of the day, let's look at and I don't want to go too long because I think we might run out of space on the memory card just now. But if you look at COVID, you know, COVID happened, which obviously was a big problem for some people. Or some people took it and made great opportunities from it, start different businesses.
Yeah.
And so it comes down to your drive and what you want to do. And so if you really want to do it, then you'd find a way, you know, so
focus on where you control and where you could control. And as I say, live with intent, live intentionally, do the things that you don't just wake up and run on automatic.
Yeah.
You know, make sure that you're doing with as much as possible every minute of the day available to you. Make sure you're moving the needle forward, even if it's just, you know, a quarter of a millimeter.
Yeah.
The needle, well, not the needle, but the stone up the hill is moving forward, so that you could make sure that the next 12 months, 300 and next year's a leap year.
I don't know.
365 minimum days are, you know, bigger and better than the last 365.
I should try to remember the leap year is the year with Olympics, or is the year with World Cup? I really had to try to remember.
Well, the Olympics switch up now, so.
Yeah, understand.
So you can't use that as a gauge anymore.
Right, so. We out.
Yeah, see you in 2022. And for all you guys, I wish you a Merry Bright New Year.
Yeah, Merry New Year. Happy New Year. Bright and successful 2022.
Nice.
Bless.
The views expressed in this podcast are simply the opinions of the guests and the hosts from their perspective. These opinions aren't necessarily facts, nor with the intent to defame any person or establishment. This is not legal, medical, financial, nor spiritual advice.